this is a simple understanding of, you know, how the you have Aries, you have Leo, and you have Sagittarius. As everybody knows, you know, Atma is the soul. It is residing in the natural fifth house. Let us not forget the basic principle of the natural fifth house, which is Atma. And the trine, Jiva, is the bioforce, which gives us the energy, the prana, the Jiva. And Deha means body. So Mars, Sun, and Jupiter, all the, you know, masculine planets, they are in the Dharma Trikona. They are helping you in, you know, giving you whatever you need in this life. Because of this, then the next is Buddhi, Bhoga, Karma. Buddhi is intellect. Bhoga, that is in Gemini. Bhoga is, you know, where the Mula Trikona of Venus is. Okay, Bhoga is enjoyment, pleasures, and karma. What is karma? It is Aquarius. This is the Mula Trikona of Saturn. Here, when you see behind, Aries is Mula Trikona of Mars, Leo is Mula Trikona of Sun, Sagittarius is Mula Trikona of Jupiter, the head office of all these planets. So if I am understanding this in my chart, then I will be able to address every problem that comes to me. Because that is where I'm saying that if you have to understand, then you will be able to understand this whole triangle of life. These two triangles. So, you know, this is, you know, the basics that I wanted to tell you. Now, the next level is to see now how the activation is going to happen. Now, for example, let me give you an example. Fourth house, I said, is the place of storage for us, is the storage karma, is the agami karma, what is coming, the thoughts. So, what is the storage of your family? Your family, your, you know, family second house. Where is the storage of the family, which is the thoughts of the family going?
Will be the fourth from the second.
Fourth from second, correct? Fourth from second. So when you become a family, the first thought is you want to have children and you're thinking about your future. So fifth house is activated. So remember, in the family, if your thoughts are negative, if your thoughts are evil towards other people, towards, you know, some people in the family, then what will happen to your fifth house, which is the storage, the fourth agami? Do you think your children will be able to manifest the best in their life? If you have, you know, greed, if you have jealousy, if you have hatred, if you have envy in your family towards other people, then your fifth house is definitely impacted. Definitely impacted. Okay. So similarly, where is the storage of your prarabdha, sixth house prarabdha? What is the storage?
The ninth.
Ninth is ancestors, forefathers. Many a problems in our lives, people don't even realize. And this is, you know, when you talk to South Indian priests, they will tell you in any number of times, you can do any puja, you can do any remedy, everything, unless your ancestors are happy, they will not allow you to enjoy the full materialistic as well as spiritual benefits on the earth plane. And they will not allow you to unfold what your prarabdha is. The thought processes, the storage of your prarabdha will not unfold till your ancestors are appeased. And they have been given their share of oblations. Prayers are not given there. Similarly, it is also your guru. That is why they say a guru has the ability to remove that, isn't it? Because it is the feet of the guru. Fourth from sixth, your prarabdha is, you know, your guru can have the ability to unfold and, you know, unravel your prarabdha or your ancestors. Even your kuladevata, very important. Especially for Indians who have a lineage of kuladevata, which means family deity, they have to go to their family deity. Many of the problems start from their family deity. Kuladevata, then grama devata. Okay? Then your pitris. These are three important. Grama devata means your village god. Where you are staying, there should be a family, you know, deity. Family deity is there, then there is a grama devata. So if you want to be successful in a place of work, then around there might be a temple, there might be a church, there might be a gurudwara, there might be a mosque. Whatever your faith is, you should go to that temple, to that mosque, to that church, that place of worship and play, because he becomes the guardian of that area. If that area in various, your workplaces, if you have to flourish there, then you have to go there. Simple rules, but many people forget. They go from pillar to post, from one astrologer to another, trying to get remedies. They wear gemstones, they do pujas, and they say, my problem is not still resolved. Because the problem, what we think, there are, you know, tapatraya. You know what is tapatraya? There are three types of tapatraya. No? Tapa, tapatraya. Adhyatmik, you know, Adi Devik, Adi Bhautik. One more is there, Adi Yagna. But Adhyatmik, spiritual. Adi Devik, which means if there has been a Deva that you have not appeased, that was, you know, worshipped by your ancestors, that will, the problem can come from. Adi Bhautik, which can come from elements and animals, from the Panchamahabhutas. There is an imbalance that you have created in the Panchamahabhutas. Today, people who are into real estate, they, you know, dig the earth, Mother Earth. You know, people who are into mining, they take, you know, extract from Mother Earth. You're creating an imbalance. You know, with deforestation, you are cutting trees and you're creating this. So you're creating an imbalance. That means you're creating an imbalance in the Adi Bhautik. So many people who are attacked by animals like dogs, or, you know, wild animals or something, they have created something imbalance in the Panchamahabhuta, in the nature. That is why they will get attacked. Or they get into some unknown accidents. Because you have created some imbalance. So did you understand? So, is there any questions, Babaji, that you have for me?
One question I will have, I think, and many people who stay in the West can have this question.
Sure.
You said ask about the Gram, Devta and something. So suppose somebody is staying in a place like, for example, I stay in Germany here, and there is no specific temple, so Hindu temple. So going to a church or a mosque, that will also do justice. That's what you feel.
Yes, I would say so. Because there might be a prominent church or a prominent gurudwara or a prominent synagogue or prominent thing in that area. And just going and giving your respect there. See, a prayer can be said anywhere. You might be from any faith and belief system. You know, a prayer hall or a place of common worship. See, this is the most difficult problem today is people have not understood even the concept of dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Today, religion has actually blinded everybody. What is dharma? What is artha? What is kama? What is moksha? Do you understand, you know, what it means?
Yes.
Because our ability to tap into the source of devotion and to the universal consciousness and our collective understanding of the cosmic principles itself is dharma. Your source with the oneness. If somebody has met with an accident on the street in front of your eyes, it is your dharma to go and help him, not see, you know, what religion, caste, creed, color he is. It's your dharma. It is not your karma. So anything which is a collective understanding based on the cosmic principles is dharma. Anything that is making yourself resourceful in tune with the cosmic principles is artha. Trying to be resourceful as well as giving some resources back. It could be in terms of time, effort, money, you know, tan, man, dhan. Tan and man. Tan means you should be completely focused on whatever you're doing. You know, tan is through body. You serve. Man, through your mind. Many people go and do voluntary service, but they are not there. Some people do checkbook culture today in India. Annadanam. You know, rice donation, I'm giving it in this temple. I'm giving, you know, 10,000 rupees check. Annadhanam was never like that. You have to cook yourself the food at your home. Serve all the pandits and everybody who has come yourself on the plantain leaf. And then you have to remove the plantain leaf, carry it on your head and then go and throw it. That is complete annadhanam. Otherwise, it is not your checkbook culture of today. Go to a temple and give. Say, I'm donating rice, I'm donating oil, I'm donating this. So, artha means making yourself resourceful in tune with the cosmic principles. Celebrating your existence in tune with the cosmic principles is karma. Karma is not only, you know, lust and passion. It is your celebration on this earth plane is karma. Being, you know, enjoying every day of your life and your existence. And moksha is where an individual's integrity to the universe is moksha. Ultimately, you are becoming one with that, you know, the ultimate divine source. So your integrity to unite with the universal consciousness and the highest consciousness is moksha. It is not about sitting in a cave and trying to say, I want liberation and spiritual liberation. You are liberated when you're self-realized. When you're self-realized, when there is no ounce of even negativity or negative thoughts towards anybody or any animal or anything. And there is only creating more Sat Chit Anand. Sat Chit Anand. That is what we want. So, if I have to now very, very quickly summarize and then we'll go to the technique that I want to say about the Nakshatra thing. The trine 159 that I was talking about, and I emphasize it so much. Usually I emphasize on one point, the simplest point too much, because 159 are the things that will help you in this life and they will go on their own. It is as though the lords of your first, fifth and ninth are like your driver. They will drive you wherever you want to, don't worry. The driver is there, the chauffeur driven car. You just have to sit behind and the fifth house lord, ninth house lord, first house lord, they're going to drive. Kendra is your angular houses. Whatever is sitting there, those things are, you have to drive yourself. You have to drive yourself. Nobody is going to come and drive you. So you take the direction of the fourth house, seventh house, tenth house. And 6, 8, 12 positions is your car is broken down and you have to push it. Did you understand? So this, if you understand the concept, so never give daan or charity for items related to your fifth and ninth house lord or your first house, the trine houses. Did you understand what I mean? Now, when I'm saying trine houses, from any house, the trine house lords. So, for your seventh house, for your spouse, for your partner, for your business, what becomes the trine houses and what becomes the most important?
3 and 11.
3 and 11 becomes very, very important. So, don't donate anything by your wife's, you know, or your spouse or your business partner should never donate anything related to those planets. Your third house planet and 11th house planet should not be donated. Because you're losing your driver. You're trying to sell. Okay, today the driver, you go and drive for somebody else.
Yeah, that's correct.
You never give. Okay? Is this clear? Now, let us go to the technique I was talking about, and I will show you one example chart. Do you have any questions, Babaji?
No, is that was very my only question.
Simple. It is a very simple thing, but when people are talking very simply, it is they think it is simplistic. But there is nothing in Jyotish except basics. If you understand the basics very clearly, you know, then you will understand many of the things. You know, you have to understand, I'm not going to introduce that. You know, there is Dhatu Mula Jiva. You know, that concept is there. Dhatu means minerals. You know, Mula means roots and plants. And Jiva means animals, animate things. Similarly, there is a principle called Srishti, Sthiti and Laya. It's the Trinity. Srishti is like Brahma. Sthiti is like Shiva. And Sthiti is like Vishnu. And Laya is Shiva. Karma, Bhoga, Nasha. So there are so many concepts we can start introducing, but I want to make it simplistic. And I will just, not simplistic, make it more simpler for people to understand so that they could be able to maximize, to understand what their karmas and where their, what areas of their chart where the highest karmas are residing so that they can address those nakshatras. Okay. So what are those things that we have to focus on is, yeah, you wanted to ask me something, Babaji?
That's all. We can start with the next.
Right. So the next topic is what I want to say. Now, based on this background we have talked about, now I want to introduce how to look at the karmas in your through your nakshatras. Now, the first question I want to ask your audiences and you is, Babaji, tell me, why have you got your ascendant or your lagna at a particular degree? And why your moon is sitting in a particular nakshatra or a star constellation in a particular pada? There is a meaning to it. Have you ever asked the question to yourself or to the universe? Why am I born with this degree? Why am I born in the Janma Nakshatra and I have been given this specific nakshatra and a specific pada in it? Because there is a big clue, which is the greatest secret which people have even not even looked. The village astrologers usually use this technique only. What is the technique? Is what is the balance of the Mahadasha when you are born? Your Mahadasha when you are born, what Mahadasha it is, where that Mahadasha Lord has gone has a very great significance. And through that Mahadasha Lord and you know the Mahadasha, you can really identify where in the maximum amount of energy you are going to spend in this lifetime. What nakshatras will be very important and where it will be activated. Because why the degree? Degree is very, very key. Because if you move a little bit over and your degrees are going to change, when your degrees are going to change, certain significations are also going to change in your chart. That is where they say Krishnamurti Paddhati system looks at even those, because he's looking at very sub Lord and all of that theory which is looking at, because he wants to know. He knows that somebody who's born a sub Lord with a different planet energy, one can be a doctor, the other can be a butcher. Twins, born, you know, a few minutes apart. One could be a carpenter, one could be a doctor. What is the difference? So everything is there in the degrees and everything is there in the balance of Mahadasha. So usually I tell people if you're born in a Ketu Nakshatra, I can, you know, very certainly tell you, it is called the bookmark theory. You know what is a bookmark theory? What do I do when I'm reading a book? I'll put a bookmark. Then I will go, I'll come back. Then I will start from the bookmark, right? Reading the book. That is what the bookmark is for. Now imagine in a past life where you had an untimely death, which is called as akala mrityu, untimely death, because of whatever reason. It could be an ailment, it could be a major car, an accident on the road, or it could be a sudden heart attack for no reason or whatever, something. Or it could be, somebody has attacked you and, killed you. It was a suicide, whatever. It is akala mrityu, which means your oxygen cylinder had enough oxygen there remaining for the rest of the life, but you have cut the cord of the oxygen cylinder, either through, some event which has happened or through your own self, like a suicide. So what happens is these people, when they are born in this life, they are born in Ketu Nakshatra, because the balance of that past, suppose they were supposed to live for 80 years of their life and they had akala mrityu, which is untimely death, at 60 years, 20 years balance is given to them in this life. That is why Ketu ruled. I'm talking about moon in Ketu Nakshatras. Whenever it is there, usually they are getting a balance. It's a bookmark. You are starting your journey from where you left. You are starting the book. It is not a new chapter. From where you had left, you are going to start your journey. So the balance of the Mahadasha is very important. And where the Mahadasha Lord, the major period Lord at birth, is very important, because you have to go through three layers or four layers. Mahadasha Lord at birth, then Antardasha or Bhukti Lord, then Pratyantar Dasha Lord, then Sukshma Dasha Lord. That is kind of giving you, it's like fingerprint. It's a cosmic blueprint that you can actually look. And the technique is very simple. To actually understand what, where and which nakshatras are holding most of my karmas, how in this life I have to release those karmas, and what nakshatras I'll have to work on